السلام عليكم ورحمة الله. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على سيد الأنبياء والمرسلين وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين. أما بعد، فأعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. ولقد أرسلنا إلى ثمود أخاهم صالحا أن اعبدوا الله فإذا هم فريقان يختصمون. قال يا قوم لم تستعجلون بالسيئة قبل الحسنة لولا تستغفرون الله لعلكم ترحمون. قالوا اطيرنا بك وبمن معك. قال طائركم عند الله بل أنتم قوم تفتنون. وكان في المدينة تسعة رهط يفسدون في الأرض ولا يصلحون. قالوا تقاسموا بالله لنبيتنه وأهله ثم لنقولن لوليه ما شهدنا مهلك أهله وإنا لصادقون. ومكروا مكرا ومكرنا مكرا وهم لا يشعرون. فانظر كيف كان عاقبة مكرهم أنا دمرناهم وقومهم أجمعين. فتلك بيوتهم خاوية بما ظلموا، إن في ذلك لآية لقوم يعلمون. وأنجينا الذين آمنوا وكانوا يتقون. So alhamdulillah, it's good to be back after a long Ramadan break. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept all of our prayers and all of our fasts, all of our charity, all of our supplications, all of our recitation of the Qur'an, and all of these other amazing acts of worship we may have done throughout the month of Ramadan. And we also ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to allow us to live long enough to witness and experience another Ramadan as well. And as all of us know, Ramadan is the month of the Qur'an. So hopefully all of us used it as an opportunity to reconnect with the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to improve and build upon our relationship with the Qur'an. So during the blessed month of Ramadan, most of us, if not all of us, we increased our frequency of reciting the Qur'an and listening to the Qur'an. And I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give all of us the tawfiq, the ability to maintain that increased frequency throughout the rest of the year. That as much Qur'an as we are reading in Ramadan and listening to in Ramadan, we continue to do so throughout the rest of the year as well. And there is absolutely nothing better than being in the masjid, the most beloved place to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, together as a community, learning about the divine words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It may seem like it's something small, something insignificant, but in reality, this activity that we're all engaged in right now is something that is extremely, extremely beloved to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's something that's a source of amazing virtues, amazing blessings, and amazing rewards. So for example, Abu Hurairah radiallahu anhu, he narrates that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, مَجْتَمَعَ قَوْمٌ فِي بُيُوتٍ مِّن بَيْتِ اللَّهِ أو مَجْتَمَعَ قَوْمٌ فِي بَيْتٍ مِّن بُيُوتِ اللَّهِ تَعَالَى يَتْلُونَ كِتَابَ اللَّهِ وَيَتَدَارَسُونَهُ بَيْنَهُمْ إِلَّا نَزَلَتْ عَلَيْهِمُ السَّكِينَةُ وَغَشِيَتْهُمُ الرَّحْمَةُ وَحَفَّتْهُمُ الْمَلَائِكَةُ وَذَكَرَهُمُ اللَّهُ فِي مَنْ عِنْدَهُ. That the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told us that no people come together in a house of the houses of Allah, meaning no group of people comes together in one of the masajid. يَتْنُونَ كِتَابَ اللَّهِ, reciting the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَيَتَدَارَسُونَهُ بَيْنَهُمْ, and studying it and learning it amongst themselves. إِلَّا نَزَّلَتْ عَلَيْهِمُ السَّكِينَةِ, except calmness, tranquility, peace descends upon them. وَغَشِيَتْهُمُ الرَّحْمَةِ, and divine mercy covers them from above. وَحَفَّتْهُمُ الْمَلَائِكَةِ, and the angels surround them. وَذَكَرَهُمُ اللَّهُ فِي مَنْ عِنْدَ, and Allah mentions them among those who are with Him. So this is a very, very beautiful hadith of the Prophet ﷺ, in which he highlights three distinct virtues, three distinct rewards for reciting and studying the Qur'an together in the masjid. So this is a hadith that highlights the importance and the virtues of what we're engaged in right now. So the three things that the Prophet ﷺ highlighted, the first is نزول السكينة. That السكينة, this calmness, this tranquility, this peace, it descends upon the gathering. So this is something that all of us can actually experience and feel. This is something that we can actually enjoy. So oftentimes, especially here in SoCal, life is extremely busy. And because life is so busy, there's a lot of stress, there's a lot of anxiety associated with it as well. So several things happen to us throughout the day that create anxiety, they create stress, and they cause our hearts and minds to be preoccupied and distracted. We are constantly using our minds, we're constantly engaged in some sort of thought, we're constantly engaged in some sort of activity. But as soon as we come into the masjid, as soon as we come into the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and we sit down to connect with His words, we can feel a sense of temporary relief. That this sakina, this special tranquility, this special contentment, it descends down upon us and into our hearts. So we can find solace, we can find peace, contentment, tranquility, and reassurance in the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala Himself, He describes the Qur'an as ash-shifa, that it is a cure, that it's something of a healing for what is inside of our hearts. So this is something that all of us, we can actually experience, and we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give us this sakina as well, right? This tranquility, this peace, this contentment inside of our hearts. The second thing that the Prophet ﷺ mentions is وَغَشْيَتْهُمُ الرَّحْمَةِ, that divine mercy actually covers them. So this rahmah, it's referring to the divine infinite mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the mercy, the rahmah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it's something that is absolutely unique. It is infinite, it's never ending and limitless. It encompasses every single thing in this universe, and it is our key to entering into Jannah. That the main key for us to get into paradise, everlasting bliss, salvation, is the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is also something that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam highlighted in a particular hadith. He told us, لَنْ يُدْخِلَ أَحَدُكُمُ الْجَنَّةَ عَمَلُ, that none of your deeds will enter you into paradise. And I know I've shared this hadith before, but the meaning of it is very powerful. That the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he wants us to understand this very, very important point, especially in terms of our relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That none of our deeds, none of our prayers, none of our fasts, none of our charity is going to enter into paradise. So when the companions heard this, they were also a little bit surprised, they were shocked. So they asked, وَلَا أَنْتَ يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ, that not even you, O Messenger of Allah. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, وَلَا أَنَا, not even me. إِلَّا أَنْ يَتَغَمَّدَنِيَ اللَّهُ بِرَحْمَتِي, unless Allah covers me, unless Allah encompasses me with His divine mercy. So one of the ways for us to earn this divine mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, this rahmah, is by coming to the masjid together as a community and learning about His words, connecting with the Qur'an, trying our best to understand it, and most importantly, implement it and bring it into our daily lives. So that's the second unique virtue that's associated with studying the Qur'an, with what we're doing right now. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala covers us with His divine mercy. وَحَفَّتْهُمُ الْمَلَائِكَةِ, the third thing that's mentioned is that the angels surround them. So the angels, they are the most pure creations of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They are this creation that exists solely for the worship and praise of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So there's other narrations that mention that whenever there's a gathering of knowledge, whenever there's a gathering of faith and iman, the angels come and join in as well. So as we're sitting here right now, they say that all of the empty spaces that we see, they are being filled by these angels. Now obviously this is something from the unseen. This is not something we can see with our own two eyes, but we accept it, we believe in it, because this is something that the Prophet ﷺ told us about. So وَحَفَّتْهُمُ الْمَلَائِكَةِ, so as we're sitting here right now, the angels are joining this gathering as well. And then the ultimate honor is mentioned. وَذَكَرَهُمُ اللَّهُ فِي مَنْ عِنْدَهُ, that Allah mentions that individual by name. And this is something that is an amazing honor. That imagine Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, our Lord, our Creator, our Sustainer, the Almighty, the All-Powerful, He's actually mentioning us by name. That Fulan so-and-so is sitting in this gathering. that he's taking time out of his busy schedule to learn about the Qur'an, to learn about these divine words, to increase his faith, to increase his iman, to increase his understanding of the Qur'an. So this activity that we are engaged in is something that is absolutely amazing. There's nothing better to do than spending time learning the Qur'an and attaching our hearts to it. And this is something that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He also highlights in the Qur'an, that the absolute best thing for us to be engaged in, the thing that we should be chasing after, the thing that we should be spending all of our time in, is learning about the Qur'an itself. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us in Surah Yunus, that يَا أَيُّهَا النَّاسِ قَدْ جَاءَتْكُمْ مَوْعِظَةٌ مِّنْ رَبِّكُمْ وَشِفَاءٌ لِمَا فِي الصُّدُورِ وَهُدًى وَرَحْمَةٌ لِلْمُؤْمِنِينَ قُلْ بِفَضْلِ اللَّهِ وَبِرَحْمَتِهِ فَبِذَلِكَ فَلْيَفْرَحُوا هُوَ خَيْرٌ مِّمَّا يَجْمَعُونَ. That, يَا أَيُّهَا النَّاسِ, O mankind. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He starts this verse by addressing all of humanity. He's not only speaking to us as believers, but He's speaking to every single human being. يَا أَيُّهَا النَّاسِ, O mankind, قَدْ جَاءَتْكُمْ مَوْعِظَةٌ مِّنْ رَبِّكُمْ, a teaching from your Lord has come to you. وَشِفَاءٌ لِمَا فِي الصُّدُورِ, and a healing, a cure for what is in your hearts. وَهُدًى وَرَحْمَةٌ لِلْمُؤْمِنِينَ, and a guidance and mercy for the believers. قُلْ بِفَضْلِ اللَّهِ وَبِرَحْمَتِي, say in God's grace and mercy, فَبِذَٰلِكَ فَلْيَفْرَحُوا, let them rejoice. هُوَ خَيْرٌ مِّمَّا يَجْمَعُونَ, these are better than everything that they gather, these are better than everything that they accumulate. So this is also a very beautiful verse in which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He gives us a very brief yet comprehensive description of the Qur'an. So essentially in this verse, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is giving us a very beautiful illustrative description of the Qur'an itself. And He describes the Qur'an with four attributes. The first is that it is a maw'idha. It's a teaching, it's a reminder from Allah. It's a shifa, it's a cure. It's huda, it's guidance. And lastly, it's rahma, it is a mercy. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He starts by describing the Qur'an as maw'idhatun min rabbikum, a teaching, a reminder, an admonition from your Lord. So in the Arabic language, the word maw'idha, it comes from the verb wa'adha ya'idhu. And this verb in the Arabic language, it's usually translated as an admonition, a warning, or a sermon. So usually in the Arabic language, when you say the word wa'adh, it's referring to a reminder. It's referring to a sermon. It could be referring to a lecture as well. So the word maw'idha itself, it can refer to a religious reminder, spiritual counsel, an admonition, or a lesson. And a maw'idha, it's defined as both a reprimand that creates a sense of fear and a reminder to do good that causes the heart to become soft. So a maw'idha, it serves this dual purpose, right? In Arabic, they describe it as زَجَرٌ مُقْتَرِنٌ بِتَخْوِيفٍ, that a maw'idha is something in which the speaker is actually reprimanding the audience. He's critiquing the audience and he's creating a sense of fear. وَتَذْكِيرٌ بِالْخَيْرٍ, but at the same time, it's a reminder with goodness. وَمَا يَرِقُّ لَهُ الْقَلْبِ, and through which the heart becomes soft. So the actual purpose of a maw'idha is to soften a person's heart. That when a person listens to this reminder, when they listen to this spiritual counsel, it has an emotional effect upon them. And more importantly, it has a spiritual effect upon them. It does something to their hearts. Their hearts actually become soft. And they become more accepting of the truth. They become more accepting of the message. And this is the exact nature of the Qur'an. That it's supposed to have a direct effect upon our hearts, causing them to become soft. And that is also something that all of us can experience as well. Right? Even though we may not understand the Qur'an properly, even though we may not understand the words being recited, but this is one of the consequences, this is one of the results of engaging with the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That it causes our hearts to become soft. Because that's part of the nature of the Qur'an. It is a maw'idha. It's something that is designed to affect our hearts directly. Right? And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala then describes it as وَشِفَاءٌ لِمَا فِي الصُّدُورِ, it is a cure for what is in your hearts. So the Qur'an, they say it's a cure for our wants and desires along with our doubts. So as human beings, we face several challenges, right? Some of the challenges we face, they are internal, and some of the challenges we face, they are external. And amongst the strongest internal challenges we have is our nafs. It's our soul and our hawa, our desires. So they say that the recitation of the Qur'an, engaging with the Qur'an, understanding the Qur'an, is a way to control those desires. It's a way to keep those wants in check. And at the same time, as human beings, we are rational beings. We use our mind, we use our intellect. And oftentimes through this rational thought process, there might be some doubts. There might be some doubts about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, some doubts about the reality of this world. But by reading the Qur'an and understanding the Qur'an, these doubts are being removed as well. So the Qur'an, it is a cure for diseases of the heart and spiritual ailments, such as disbelief, hypocrisy, pride, arrogance, jealousy, hatred, enmity, anxiety, and stress. And the Qur'an, it cures all of these, and it replaces them with belief, with humility, with love, and contentment. So primarily the Qur'an is this spiritual cure. But it can also be used as a physical cure, right? There are several narrations from the Prophet ﷺ that encourage us to recite certain verses from the Qur'an. For example, Surah Al-Fatiha as a cure. That if a person believes in the power of the Qur'an and they believe in the power of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and the person reciting it and the person who's being recited upon believes in it, then it can also serve as a physical cure as well. So the Qur'an is being described as shifa'un lima fi sudur. It is a cure for what is inside of people's hearts. And the third description is that the Qur'an is a guidance, huda, right? It is a guidance, and that is the actual main purpose of the Qur'an. To provide us as human beings with guidance in the life of this world. Guidance that will direct us towards the divine, towards belief and salvation, and success both in this life and the life to come. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He tells us that the Qur'an is guidance for all of humanity. It's hudan lil-nas. But more specifically, it's a guidance for the people of taqwa. It is hudan lil-muttaqeen. That the people who truly believe in Allah and they are conscious of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they will actually benefit from the guidance of the Qur'an. And if you want to give a one-word summary of the Qur'an, it is hidayah. Right, a one-word summary that captures the essence of the Qur'an is that it is a book of guidance. Every single thing that's mentioned in the Qur'an is mentioned with the ultimate aim, the ultimate goal of guiding us towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, guiding us towards salvation. And the fourth description that's given is rahmah, hudan wa rahmatun lilmu'mineen, that it is a mercy for the believers, that it is through the Qur'an that we are guided in this world and we are taught how to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That the Qur'an is a source of immense blessings, virtues and rewards in our life, and it will be a proof for us on the Day of Judgment, and it will intercede on our behalfs. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in this verse, He's given us this very brief yet beautiful comprehensive description of the Qur'an. That it's maw'idhatun min rabbikum. It is this heart softener from your Lord. وَشِفَاءٌ لِمَا فِي الصُّدُورِ It's a cure for what's inside of people's chests. وَهُدَى It's a guidance. وَرَحْمَةٌ And a mercy. لِلْمُؤْمِنِينَ For the believers. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He addresses the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He says, قُلْ بِفَضْلِ اللَّهِ وَبِرَحْمَةِ فَبِذَٰلِكَ فَلْيَفْرَحُوا هُوَ خَيْرٌ مِمَّا يَجْمَعُونَ Say, right, tell your companions, tell your community, in Allah's grace and mercy, let them rejoice. That your community, the believers, they should be happy, they should be elated, they should be extremely happy with the grace and mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. These are better than everything that they gather. So according to most of the commentators of the Qur'an, the word fadl in this verse, the word grace, it's referring to iman. And the word rahmah, the word mercy, it's referring to the Qur'an. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He's telling the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that tell the companions that they should rejoice, they should be happy, they should be elated, they should be content with these two immense and invaluable blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So basically, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is highlighting two of the most valuable gifts that He has given to us as human beings. The first being iman, the fact that we believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and the second being the Qur'an. So this is actually a very profound statement, that we as human beings, we are naturally inclined towards material things. That is part of human nature. That as human beings, material things have been made attractive for us. And the life of this world and all of its pleasures and enjoyments have been made to seem attractive to us. And this is a reality that's also mentioned in the Quran. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us in Surah Ali Imran that زُيِّنَ لِلنَّاسِ حُبُّ الشَّهَوَاتِ. The love of desirable things has been made alluring for mankind. Right? زُيِّنَ has been beautified, has been adorned, has been made attractive. حُبُّ الشَّهَوَاتِ. The love of desires, the love of wants. So the love of all of these things has been beautified, has been adorned, has been made to look attractive, linnas, for mankind. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He mentions some examples. مِنَ النِّسَاءِ وَالْبَنِينَ وَالْقَنَاطِيرِ الْمُقَنْطَرَةِ مِنَ الذَّهَبِ وَالْفِضَّةِ وَالْخَيْلِ الْمُسَوَّمَةِ وَالْأَنْعَامِ وَالْحَرْثِ. Amongst these desirable things are women and children, gold and silver treasures piled up high, horses with fine markings, livestock, and farmland. So basically, he highlights all of these material things that we are constantly chasing after. That if you look throughout the history of mankind, every single generation has always been chasing after material wealth, material belongings, trying to become as rich and powerful as possible. And all of these things have been made to look attractive to us as human beings. So we are naturally inclined towards these things. But then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, ذَلِكَ مَتَاعُ الْحَيَاةِ الدُّنْيَا. That all of these things are the temporary joys of this life. Right? The word mata in the Arabic language, it can have several different meanings, several different connotations, but one of them is temporary enjoyment. So ذَلِكَ مَتَاعُ الْحَيَاةِ الدُّنْيَا. All of these things that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala just mentioned, they are the temporary enjoyments of the life of this world. وَاللَّهُ عِنْدَهُ حُسْنُ الْمَآبِ. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He has the best place, the best thing to return to. And then He mentions what that is. قُلْ أَأُنَبِّئُكُمْ بِخَيْرٍ مِّن ذَلِكُمْ. Right? Say, would you like me to tell you of the things that are better than all of these? So He's speaking to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that say to your companions, أَأُنَبِّئُكُمْ بِخَيْرٍ مِّن ذَلِكُمْ. Shall I not inform you, shall I not tell you about what is better than every single thing that has just been mentioned? لِلَّذِينَ اتَّقَوْ عِنْدَ رَبِّهِمْ جَنَّاتٌ تَجْرِي مِنْ تَحْتِهَا الْأَنْهَارُ خَالِدِينَ فِيهَا وَأَزْوَاجٌ مُطَهَرَةٌ وَرِضْوَانٌ مِنَ اللَّهِ وَاللَّهُ بَصِيرٌ بِالْعِبَادِ. That their Lord will give those who are mindful of Allah gardens beneath which rivers flow, where they will stay with pure spouses in God's good pleasure, and Allah is fully aware of His servants. So basically, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying is that the hereafter and the reward of the hereafter and paradise and everything in paradise is way better than anything in the life of this world. Right? أَأُنَبِّئُكُمْ بِخَيْرٍ مِّن ذَلِكُمْ. Shall I not tell you what's better than what's been mentioned? لِلَّذِينَ اتَّقَوْا. That for those people who have taqwa, for those people who are conscious of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they will have عِنْدَ رَبِّهِمْ جَنَّاتِ. They will have gardens beneath which rivers flow. خَالِدِينَ فِيهَا. They will live there for all of eternity. وَأَزْوَاجٌ مُطَهَرَةٌ. Pure spouses. وَرِضْوَانٌ مِّنَ اللَّهِ. And they will have this pleasure, this reward from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَاللَّهُ بَصِيرٌ بِالْعِبَادِ. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is fully aware of His servants. And then He describes who these people are. الَّذِينَ يَقُولُونَ رَبَّنَا إِنَّنَا آمَنَّا فَاغْفِرْ لَنَا ذُنُوبَنَا وَقِنَا عَذَابَ النَّارِ. Those who say, our Lord, we have believed. رَبَّنَا إِنَّنَا آمَنَّا. So the first quality of these individuals, of the people who recognize the value of the hereafter, who recognize that the life of this world is insignificant, they are the ones who say, we have believed. So their first quality is that of iman, is that of faith. فَاغْفِرْ لَنَا ذُنُوبَنَا. And as people of faith, they recognize that they are weak, that they have faults, that they have shortcomings, that they make mistakes. So they ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for forgiveness. So فَاغْفِرْ لَنَا ذُنُوبَنَا وَقِنَا عَذَابَ النَّارِ. And protect us from the punishment of the fire. الصَّابِرِينَ وَالصَّادِقِينَ وَالْقَانِتِينَ وَالْمُنْفِقِينَ وَالْمُسْتَغْفِرِينَ بِالْأَسْحَارِ. That those who are steadfast, that not only are they people of faith, but they're also people of sabr. They're people of patience, of steadfastness, of fortitude. والصادقين, they are truthful. والقانتين, they are truly devout. والمنفقين والمستغفرين بالأسحار, who give and pray before dawn for forgiveness. So this is a very, very beautiful passage in Surah Ali Imran, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is reminding us about the temporary nature of the life of this world and all of its pleasures and enjoyments. That all of the material things of this world will eventually come to an end. That the money, the clothes, the homes, the cars, the status, the fame, the popularity, all of it is going to come to an end. That none of these things will last. These are not the things we should be chasing after. Rather, all of our time, our energy and resources should be directed towards chasing something that's much better. And that's what's being said in Surah Yunus. قُلْ بِفَضْلِ اللَّهِ وَبِرَحْمَتِي فَبِذَٰلِكَ فَلْيَفْرَحُوا هُوَ خَيْرٌ مِّمَّا يَجْمَعُونَ. That we should be chasing after what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has gifted us with. That what Allah has gifted us with is way better. And that's why all of our teachers, they would say that there's absolutely no better way for us to be spending our time than studying the Qur'an and trying our best to understand the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. هُوَ خَيْرٌ مِّمَّا يَجْمَعُونَ. Right, this activity that we're involved in right now, it is way better than anything else that we can accumulate. It's better than anything else that we can gather. That this is the absolute most beneficial, the most valuable way to spend our time. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants us to recognize the value of these two blessings, and that they are way better than the material blessings we enjoy in this world. And once we recognize their value, we will see an immediate and lasting change in our lives. And that is just the ultimate truth. That once we recognize the true value of faith, once we recognize the true value of Iman, and we recognize the true value of the Qur'an, then automatically changes will start coming into our lives. Automatically our perspective on the world will change. The way we view things will change. The way we interpret information will change. The way we process things will change as well. Because we'll be looking at everything through the prism of faith. We'll be looking at everything through the prism of the Qur'an. And that is essentially what the Qur'an is supposed to do. Right? The Qur'an is supposed to change our lives. It's supposed to change our hearts. It's supposed to change our minds. So that now when we're living in this world, we are living in this world according to principles and values mentioned in the Qur'an. That we get this Qur'anic worldview. We get this Qur'anic understanding of how to live our lives. And that's why it's so important to engage with the Qur'an. That's why it's so important for us to spend time learning and understanding the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also tells us in Surah Zumar that Allah nazzala ahsan al-hadith kitaban mutashabihan mathaniya taqsha'irru minhu juludu alladhina yakhshawna rabbahum thumma taninu juluduhum wa qulubuhum ila dhikrillah dhalika hudallah يَهْدِي بِهِ مَنْ يَشَاءُ وَمَنْ يُضْلِلِ اللَّهُ فَمَا لَهُ مِنْ هَادٍ. Right, another very beautiful passage in which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala describes the Qur'an. So he starts by saying, اللَّهُ نَزَّلَ أَحْسَنَ الْحَدِيثِ. That Allah has sent down the most beautiful of all teachings. كِتَابًا, a scripture. مُتَشَابِهًا, that is consistent. مَثَانِيَ, and draws comparisons. تَقْشَعِرُّ مِنْهُ جُلُودُ الَّذِينَ يَخْشَوْنَ رَبَّهُمْ. That causes the skin of those in awe of their Lord to shiver. ثُمَّ تَلِينُ جُلُودُهُمْ وَقُلُوبُهُمْ إِلَىٰ ذِكْرِ اللَّهِ. Then their skins and their hearts soften at the mention of Allah. ذَلِكَ هُدَى اللَّهِ. That is the guidance of Allah. يَهْدِي بِهِ مَنْ يَشَاءَ. He guides whomever He wills. وَمَنْ يُضْلِلِ اللَّهُ فَمَا لَهُ مِنْ هَادٍ. And whomever Allah allows to be misguided or misled, then there will be no one to guide him. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He starts this verse by describing the Qur'an as well. So the first thing that we learn from this verse is that it is direct revelation from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allahu nazzala. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone is the one who sent down this revelation to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So the first point that we're learning from this verse is that the Qur'an is divine in nature. That the Qur'an is divine, it's actual revelation. These are the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then he describes it as أحسن الحديث. The best or the most beautiful of all teachings. The best discourse, the best speech, the best narrative. So the Qur'an is أحسن الحديث because it is the divine speech of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And it's reported that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, فَضْلُ الْقُرْآنِ عَلَى سَائِرِ الْكَلَامِ كفضل الله على خلقه. That the superiority of the Quran over all other speech is similar to the superiority of Allah over His creation. That the absolute most best speech, the best discourse, the best lessons, the best morals, the best reminders are all found inside of the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It is ahsanul hadith. It is the most beautiful, the most perfect, the most eloquent, the most profound speech that exists. And the Quran is the most beautiful in words and meanings and expressions. Allah then describes two aspects of its beauty and eloquence. So we're being told that it's ahsanul hadith, it's the most beautiful of speech. But how is it beautiful? What are the aspects of its eloquence? Mutashabihan and mathaniya. Now these are difficult words to translate. And one of the better translations given is consimilar and paired. So one of the translations for the word mutashabihan is consimilar and mathaniya is paired. So consimilar can be understood to mean that each part is as eloquent as the next. That when you look towards the entire Quran, every single word, every single sentence, every single construction is as eloquent as the next. There's no discrepancy in the beauty of the Quran, right? There's no changing, there's no alteration in terms of its eloquence, in terms of how profound the Quran is. So to allude to the manner in which many parts resemble each other. Right? Another way that mathani is understood is that many parts of the Qur'an resemble other parts. That there are certain themes, there are certain concepts, there are certain ideas that are repeated throughout the entire Qur'an. It can also refer to various recurring phrases. Or it can refer to the manner in which particular qualities such as beauty and wisdom or truth and immutability are found throughout. Or to mean that each part confirms the other parts. So consimilar, mutashabihan, it can carry several different meanings. It can carry several different connotations. That's why it's so hard to actually translate this word into English. Mutashabihan, the actual linguistic meaning, is resemblance. So each part of the Quran resembles the other. Now how does it resemble the other? That's open to interpretation. That's where the commentators, that's where the mufassirun come in, and they try to describe how each part of the Quran resembles the other. So in terms of beauty, in terms of eloquence, in terms of its miraculous nature, in terms of how profound is it, in terms of how deep the meanings may be. Now, mathaniya paired, it refers to the way that many opposites are juxtaposed in the Qur'an, such as heaven and hell, believers and disbelievers, the pious and the non-pious, reward and punishment. Mathaniya, that we find these concepts, we find these ideas being paired together in the Qur'an. And this is actually part of the unique style of the Qur'an. That whenever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks about faith and He talks about iman, there will always be a discussion of disbelief and kufr. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks about paradise and reward, there will be a discussion of hellfire and punishment as well. So we see this pairing in the Qur'an. So as part of the beauty and eloquence that is being highlighted, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions an example of this pairing or juxtaposition. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Allahu nazzala ahsan al-hadith. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one who has set down the most beautiful of speeches. Mutashabihan is consimilar, mathaniya paired. And then He describes one of these pairings. He actually highlights one of these examples. That it causes the skins of those in awe of their Lord to shiver. تَقْشِعِرُ مِنْهُ جُلُودُ الَّذِينَ يَخْشَوْنَ رَبَّهُمْ ثُمَّ تَنِينُ جُلُودُهُمْ وَقُلُوبُهُمْ إِلَى ذِكْرِ اللَّهِ. So you see this juxtaposition, this opposite ends. That some people, when they listen to the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it gives them goosebumps. It actually creates a sense of fear inside of their hearts. And other people, when they listen to the Qur'an, تَنِينُ جُلُودُهُمْ وَقُلُوبُهُمْ إِلَى ذِكْرِ اللَّهِ. That their skin, their heart becomes soft at the mention of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this portion of the verse is also highlighting the nature of our relationship with the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That as believers, as people who are consciously listening to these words, how is it supposed to affect our hearts? That the Qur'an is supposed to have a direct, profound and lasting effect upon our hearts. It's supposed to pull on our emotional strings. It's supposed to fill our hearts with love for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Love for His Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. It's supposed to fill our hearts with tremendous hope and at the same time with this deep level of fear. And that is part of the nature of the Qur'an as well. That a lot of the passages of the Qur'an, they are designed to increase the sense of hope within our hearts. The sense of al-raja. That we hope in the mercy, the forgiveness, the grace, the bounty of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. that when we read certain passages, when we read certain verses, it increases the sense of hope in our hearts. But at the same time, there are other passages that actually create a sense of fear. That when we read about descriptions of the afterlife, when we read about descriptions of punishment, descriptions of hellfire, about previous nations being destroyed because of their disbelief, it's supposed to create this sense of fear within our hearts as well. And it's this feeling of hope and fear, this balance, that is the essence of Iman. And we've talked about this several times before as well. But the scholars, they would mention, Al-Iman bayn al-khawfi wal-raja, that true faith, true Iman, it lies somewhere in between hope and fear. That as believers, we are supposed to hope in the mercy, the forgiveness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But at the same time, we fear His punishment, we fear His anger. And it's this balance between hope and fear that allows us to stay steadfast upon the straight path. Right? Imam al-Ghazali rahimahullah, he designs or he describes or mentions that our relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is built upon love. So he gives this metaphor. He says that you can imagine love as a bird. So the main essence is love, which is the body of the bird. But the two wings of this bird are hope and fear. So if you have both of these wings, then the bird is able to fly and maintain. But if you have one, it creates imbalance. If there's only fear, it will be imbalanced. If it's only hope, it's going to be imbalanced. So faith is this balancing act between hope and fear. And it's this balance that keeps us steadfast on the straight path. And that is what the Qur'an does. That if we actually focus on the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, if we reflect and ponder over its meanings, it's going to create these two feelings within our hearts as well. So for example, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He tells us in Surah Al-Anfal, that إِنَّمَا الْمُؤْمِنُونَ الَّذِينَ إِذَا ذُكِرَ اللَّهُ وَجِلَتْ قُلُوبُهُمْ وَإِذَا تُلِيَتْ عَلَيْهِمْ آيَاتُ زَادَتْهُمْ إِيمَانًا. That the believers are those that when Allah is mentioned, their hearts shake. وَجِلَتْ قُلُوبُهُمْ. And this is a question that all of us should be asking ourselves. That when we hear the mention of Allah, when we hear His name being recited, when we hear His name being mentioned, how does it affect us? Does it do something inside of our hearts? Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying that the believers are those that when His name is mentioned, إِذَا ذُكِرَ اللَّهُ وَجِلَتْ قُلُوبُهُمْ. Their hearts actually shake. وَإِذَا تُلِيَتْ عَلَيْهِمْ آيَاتُ زَادَتْهُمْ إِيمَانًا. And when His verses are recited unto them, it increases them in faith. It increases them in Iman. That every single time we read the Qur'an, every single time we listen to the Qur'an being recited, it is supposed to strengthen our Iman. It's supposed to increase our faith. It's supposed to increase our love for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the Qur'an is extremely powerful, right? The Qur'an is extremely transformative. And that is why our reading of the Qur'an, it should not be mechanical or simply ritual. Rather, it should be purposeful. That when we're reciting the Qur'an, we're trying our best to engage with the Qur'an intellectually, spiritually, and emotionally. And this type of engagement is encouraged by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That there are two instances in the Qur'an where He asks this rhetorical question. That أَفَلَا يَتَدَبَّرُونَ الْقُرْآنِ. Do the people not reflect, do they not ponder over the Qur'an? أَفَلَا يَتَدَبَّرُونَ الْقُرْآنِ. So although this is a rhetorical question, most of the commentators mention that this is a command from Allah. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is commanding us to do at-tadabbur. And tadabbur, it's this deep reflection, right? It's this deep insight that every single verse we recite, we actually take a moment and we pause. And we try to reflect and ponder over its meanings. That what exactly is it that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying in this verse, right? What is the meaning? What are the lessons? What are the morals that can be derived? How can I make this verse practical for my own life? How can I relate myself to this particular verse? And then how can I act upon it? So this act of tadabbur is something that takes time. It's something that takes effort. And that's why we say that our reciting of the Qur'an, it shouldn't be mechanical. It's not supposed to be something that's just done as a ritual. That we try to recite as much Qur'an as possible. That we try to do a khatma every so often. Right? That's also good. That's also encouraged. It's also sort of a source of reward. But the real purpose is at-tadabbur. أَفَلَا يَتَدَبَّرُونَ الْقُرْآنِ. And this tadabbur, they say this is the actual objective behind our recitation of the Qur'an. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Surah Sa'd, He tells us, كِتَابٌ أَنزَلْنَاهُ إِلَيْكَ مُبَارَكٌ لِيَدَبَّرُوا آيَاتِ وليتذكر أولو الألباب. So in this verse, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He's also speaking directly to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And He tells him, كِتَابٌ أَنزَلْنَاهُ إِلَيْكَ مُبَارَكٌ. That, O Muhammad, this is a blessed book that we have revealed to you. So even in this verse, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He starts by giving us a description of the Qur'an. And this description is very simple. It's just one single word, مُبَارَكٌ, that the Qur'an is blessed. And this is something that all of us understand, that the Qur'an is blessed in every single way you can think of. Every single aspect of the Qur'an is full of barakah. It's full of blessings. Why? Because it comes from the direct source of every single blessing that exists. It's coming from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So every single aspect of the Qur'an is blessed, and it's full of blessings, and it's also a sort of blessings in our life as well. That the words, the sentence structures, the grammar, the syntax, the lessons, the morals, the commands, the prohibitions, everything in the Qur'an is mubarak. And that's why when we look towards the ahadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, we find that there are so many blessings associated with simply reciting the Qur'an. So for example, tonight we started off the session by mentioning one hadith that highlights four unique blessings of the Qur'an. The first again being Nuzul al-Sakina, that this contentment, this tranquility, this peace descends upon the gathering. That then the divine mercy covers that gathering. Then the angels surround that gathering. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions the people in that gathering by name. So all of that is barakah, right? All of that is a source of barakah. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told us, خَيْرُكُمْ مَنْ تَعَلَّمَ الْقُرْآنَ وَعَلَّمَ. That the best amongst you are those who teach the Qur'an or learn the Qur'an and teach it to others. That the absolute best believers, right, the absolute best of amongst us are those who learn the Qur'an and teach it to others. And why is that? Right? Why is it that the people of the Qur'an are being described as the best of people? Because the assumption is that if a person is learning the Qur'an, they're not only learning how to recite it properly, they're not only learning how to recite it or have it memorized, but they're actually learning the deeper meanings of the Qur'an. Those meanings that are supposed to transform the individual, that change the individual, that make them follow in the example of the Prophet ﷺ, that changes their belief, it changes their akhlaq, it changes their character. And they are the best of people because they are people of the Qur'an. So خَيْرُكُمْ مَنْ تَعَلَّمَ الْقُرْآنَ وَعَلَّمَ. The best amongst you are those who learn the Qur'an and then teach it to others. And this is a virtue that all of us have the opportunity to be involved in. Right? Every single one of us can be involved in some way, shape or form in learning and teaching the Qur'an. And you know, coming here every Wednesday night, inshallah, is an aspect of that. It's an aspect of learning the Qur'an, and inshallah, whatever we learn, we can pass that on as well. Part of the blessings of the Qur'an is that every single letter we recite, we're being rewarded. مَنْ قَرَأَ حَرْفًا مِنْ كِتَابِ اللَّهِ فَلَهُ حَسَنًا. That whoever recites one letter from the book of Allah, they get a reward. وَالْحَسَنَةُ بِعَشْرِ أَمْثَالِهَا. And that reward is multiplied by 10. And then very beautifully the Prophet ﷺ says, وَلَا أَقُولُ أَلِفْ لَا مِيمْ حَرْفٍ. I'm not saying that أَلِفْ لَا مِيمْ is a letter. وَلَكِنْ أَلِفٌ حَرْفٌ وَلَامٌ حَرْفٌ وَمِيمٌ حَرْفٌ. But alif is a separate letter, lam is a separate letter, meem is a separate letter. So every single letter we recite of the Qur'an, we are getting this huge, immense amount of reward. All of this barakah, all of this blessing is being brought into our lives just by the mere simple recitation. And this is also something beautiful. And this is why the scholars say that just the simple act of reciting the Qur'an is an act of worship. It is ibadah, right? Reciting the Qur'an, even though we don't understand it, is also an act of ibadah. And this is a common objection that people bring up. Right? A common objection that people bring up is, why do we read the Qur'an in Arabic when we don't understand the language? Right? Why do we recite the Qur'an? Why do children memorize the Qur'an and they don't know what they're saying? They have no clue what they're reciting. So our teachers would respond by saying that, yes, the actual objective is to understand it, but reciting it is also an act of worship. And reading the words is also an act of worship. And they would use this hadith as a proof. They would say, look at the example that the Prophet ﷺ gave. He used the example of alif, lam, mim. Right? This is a phrase, or these are letters in the Qur'an that no one knows their meaning. Only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows the meaning of these letters. So just a simple recitation is definitely an act of worship. It's definitely something that brings barakah and blessings into our lives. Right? The Prophet ﷺ says, اقرأوا القرآن فَإِنَّهُ يَأْتِي شَفِيعًا لِأَصْحَابِهِ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ. That recite the Qur'an because it's going to come as an intercessor for its companion on the Day of Judgment. That on the Day of Judgment, when we're standing in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, if we were companions of the Qur'an will actually come and argue on our behalf. It will intercede on our behalf in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the wording in this hadith is also interesting. It says, لِأَصْحَابِهِ. Right? It comes from the word صُحْبَة, which means companionship. And companionship, it implies that there's this strong relationship. That it's something that you're constantly hanging out with. That the Qur'an is something you're constantly spending time with. So صُحْبَة, company or companionship, that's the nature of the relationship we should have with the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that's also a source of barakah, that source of blessings. But again, all of these blessings that are being highlighted, those are not the objective behind reciting the Qur'an. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions what the purpose is. لِيَدَّبَّرُوا آيَاتِ. So that people can do التَّدَبُّر. So people can reflect, they can ponder, they can think over its verses. So the main reason, the main objective behind why we recite the Qur'an, behind why we listen to the Qur'an, should be this act of التَّدَبُّر. Now what exactly is تَدَبُّر? Right, tadabbur is this deep reflection, this deep insight, this deep thought. It's something that requires us to actually use our minds. It requires us to use our intellect. That first and foremost, there's this surface level of understanding. Right, when we read the Qur'an, for those of you who know the Arabic language, or for those of us who understand Arabic, then there's a surface level meaning that you get from just listening to the words, or from simply reciting the words. But that's not what tadabbur is. Tadabbur is a little bit of a deeper level. That you actually go down and you try to think and ponder that why is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala using certain words and not other words? Or what is the message behind this verse? What's the main theme? What's the topic? What's the objective? That why is it that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions what He's mentioning in this verse? And then how does it relate to my life? Right? How is it something that I can act upon? How is this something that I can actually make a part of my daily routine? And again, that requires time, that requires effort, and that requires an understanding of the Arabic language. That's why learning Arabic is so important. But again, learning Arabic might be too difficult, maybe we're too old, whatever. If you're not able to learn Arabic, then at least know the meanings, the translations of the Qur'an as well. Because that will help in your tadabbur, that will help in this deep reflection. And why do we do this deep reflection? وَلِيَتَذَكَّرَ أُولُو الْأَلْبَامِ. So the people of intellect, the people of understanding, they will be reminded. That every single time we read the Qur'an, we are reminded of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Every single verse, every single word that we recite, every single word we listen to, it's reminding us of who Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala truly is. That there is a Lord, there is a Creator, that He is the Almighty, the All-Powerful, the All-Knowing, the All-Hearing, the All-Seeing, the Most Wise, the Most Merciful. Right? Every single time we recite the Qur'an, we get this tadhakkur. وَلِيَتَذَكَّرَ أُولُو الْأَلْبَامِ. So we're going to be reminded about Allah. We are going to be reminded about our purpose in life. That why is it that we as human beings exist? And this is something that we are constantly in need of a reminder for. Because again, especially here in America, right? Especially the culture we have and how life is structured, there are so many distractions. We are constantly engaged in something. We're constantly busy with something. So every single day we need this reminder. We need to be grounded. We need to be reminded that our purpose in life is not the life of this world. Right? Our purpose in life is not to make all that money and to have the nice cars and have the nice house, etc. All those things are permissible, we can engage in it. But that is not the objective in life. The actual objective, the actual purpose is to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Is to achieve salvation, is to earn His mercy, to earn His forgiveness. Right? And that's what we should be engaged in. Now that doesn't mean you become a hermit and you live in a mountain somewhere, you become a monk. As a matter of fact, Islam discourages that. The Prophet ﷺ told us, لَا رَهْبَانِيَّةَ فِي الْإِسْلَامِ. There's no such thing as monasticism in Islam. There's no such thing as being a monk. Right? We are not told to abandon the world and go live in a mountain and dedicate our entire lives to worship. That is not what Islam wants from us. Even Allah in the Quran says, وَلَا تَنْسَ نَصِيبَكَ مِنَ الدُّنْيَا. That don't forget your portion from the life of this world. So meaning, yes, we can engage, we can earn money, we can get an education, we live in this world, we have to function in this world, but that should not become our primary objective. Everything, all those things should not take us away, or they should not distract us from the worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That we maintain this balance. And all those things that we're engaged in, we're doing it within the parameters that are defined by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That there's a proper way of engaging with this world. There's a proper way of earning money. There's a proper way of getting an education. Right? There's a proper way of doing social dealings and social interactions. So we're staying within those parameters. And if we stay within those parameters, we have the right intention, then even all of that becomes an act of worship. So even our education, our earning money, our spending on our families and spending time with our families, all of that becomes ibadah as well. As long as it's being done with a proper intention. So that's part of what the Qur'an does. That every single time we recite the Qur'an, we are reminded of our true purpose in life, which is ibadah. It is the worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Every time we read the Qur'an, we are reminded about reward. We're reminded about punishment. We're reminded about paradise. We're reminded about hell. So the actual main purpose of the Qur'an is this act of tadabbur, and it's this act of tadakkur. So tadabbur, deep reflection, and the second, getting a reminder from that reflection. So alhamdulillah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us the Qur'an. This is one of the greatest blessings that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given to us. He has given us this book of guidance. He has given us this hidayah. He has given us a roadmap to success in this world. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He created us, He placed us in this world, but He actually gave us a roadmap on how to be successful in it as well. And our job is to now use this roadmap. Right? Our job is to engage with the Qur'an, recite the Qur'an, try our best to understand the Qur'an, but most importantly, live our lives according to the Qur'an as well. And that has been the intention behind all of these classes that we've been doing every single Wednesday night. Alhamdulillah, we've been doing it for the past 5 years, 6 years now. Right? We started with Surah Al-Kahf, and we're all the way on Surah Al-Naml. And inshallah, the intention is to continue doing this class as long as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allows us to do so. And as long as we're able to do so, we will continue with this class. And the ultimate intention, inshallah, is to get through the entire Qur'an, however long it takes. Might take several years, but inshallah, we will keep doing it. So the main goal, the main purpose of this class, and why I do it myself, is that it gives us this opportunity to engage with the Qur'an at perhaps a little bit of a deeper level. And the reason for that is because, you know, most of us, we don't know the Arabic language, which is a huge barrier, it's a huge hindrance. Because the key to unlocking the treasures of the Qur'an is the language itself. That if we truly want a deep, profound, insightful understanding of these words, we have to learn the language. But if we are unable to learn the language, then we should still put an effort to understand them through translations. But the problem with translations is that a translation is not the Qur'an. Right? A translation is not the Qur'an. A translation is someone's interpretation of what the Qur'an is saying. So every single translation will have its pros, will have its cons. It will have some strengths, it will have some weaknesses. So we should all find a translation that we're comfortable with, that we can read and recite and understand. But the problem with the translation is that there is literally a lot that's lost in translation. That when the translation is written, there's several things that are missing. Because the Qur'an, it's not structured like a regular book. Right? The way that the Qur'an is structured is that it's not like a novel with a beginning, a middle, and an end. It's not structured like a textbook where there's one topic and all the verses that speak about it. Right? It's not like there's a surah on sabr and all the verses of sabr are mentioned. It's not like there's a surah on taqwa and all these things of taqwa are mentioned. That the Qur'an is structured in a very unique, a very divine way. Right? It's structured, they say, in this circular manner. That there's actually no beginning and there's no end to the Qur'an. That anywhere you pick up, anywhere you recite, you can get some sort of benefit from it. So because of its unique structure, and because of how the phrases and the verses are put together and how they're placed together, a translation oftentimes doesn't do justice to the Qur'an. That's why it's so important to actually read a commentary, right? To actually read a tafsir, an explanation, an exegesis of the Qur'an that provides the background, that provides the history, it provides the context, perhaps it provides the reasons for revelation of particular verses. Because all of that plays a very important role in providing context and understanding the Qur'an properly. Because obviously the Qur'an was not revealed in a vacuum. Right? The Qur'an was revealed under certain circumstances in a certain environment during a certain time to the Prophet ﷺ, who was facing certain challenges in his life. So understanding the verses in that context is also very important. And that context is oftentimes provided by tafsir. But again, when it comes to the Qur'an, you know, a lot of times traditionally, there is this barrier. And this barrier has been like perpetuated in our communities as well. That you cannot approach the Qur'an without having someone else help you with it. That is not the case. That all of us should try our best to engage with the Qur'an as much as possible. Right? Don't fear that you're not going to understand anything that is going to be too difficult. We should just pick it up, we should read it, recite it, and read the translation along with it. And then obviously engage and attend classes, you know, like these or any other tafsir classes that exist, and try our best to get a stronger understanding of the Qur'an. So inshallah, this was, you know, today was just a warm-up for the rest of the week, so when we start inshallah. So what we will do is next week we'll pick up from verse number 45. And verse number 45 is starting off with the story of Salih alayhi salam. So far we have covered in Surah An-Naml several stories of prophets. We've covered the story of Musa and Dawood alayhi salam. Then we covered the story of Sulaiman alayhi salam in quite some detail. And we completed that before Ramadan. So inshallah, next Wednesday, we're going to start with the story of Salih with the people of Thamud. Alright, so are there any questions before we end for tonight, inshallah?
You mentioned the Quran was Hidayah. What, is that related to the word Huda? Is there a difference, or is there a reason why you chose that word, or, you know, it's just the,
so it's
the other word mentioned is guidance.
Yeah, so both words, Huda and Hidayah, they're from the same root letter, and I believe they carry the same meanings as well. I think they're just two different, they're two different verbal nouns for the same word. So hada, yahdi, hidayah, and huda, they convey the same meaning. So in some places Allah describes the Quran as hidayatul linnas, and sometimes as huda linnas. Any other questions? No questions, that's a good sign or a bad sign.
Some of the people say that the Quran and these things should be only studied by the scholars, and the general people should not try to, enter in this subject. So that way, they only go for reading the translations of some of the hadiths, and they don't go in the Quran detail.
Yeah.
It's only the scholars' business.
Yeah. So when looking towards the verses of the Qur'an, there's two categories, right? There is those verses that their meanings are general and simple enough for everybody to understand. Because you have to understand that the Qur'an was revealed to an illiterate nation, right? The Qur'an was revealed to whom? Arabs, right? This Arabian society that was not used to writing and reading, they didn't, but there's verses and topics in the Qur'an that are for everyone to understand. So for example, verses that talk about iman, that talk about faith, or that talk about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they talk about the blessings of Allah, or they talk about stories, right? They talk about past nations and things like that. They talk about paradise and hell. These are verses that everyone can understand. You don't need a scholar to explain them to you, right? You don't need any previous context. These are concepts that are designed to enter straight into your heart. And these are what we call these would be what you would refer to as like usuluddin, right? These are the actual principles, foundations of belief. Like taqwa and iman and sabr and tawakkul, like all these concepts are things that everyone can understand. But then there's a separate category of verses which have to do with legal rulings, with ahkam. That's where the warning comes in. That don't try to interpret those legal rulings on your own. That requires context, that requires expertise, that requires people who have deep knowledge and understanding of the sunnah, and they have deep knowledge and understanding of usul al-fiqh and things like that. So for example, there's several warnings from the Prophet ﷺ about interpreting the Qur'an without knowledge. That whoever speaks regarding the Qur'an with their own opinion, then let them prepare their seat in the hellfire. This is the actual hadith from the Prophet ﷺ. So that warning is for interpreting verses like that. But when it comes to verses about iman and sabr and tawakkul and yaqeen and things like that, then that's open for everyone. You can approach those, you can understand it, you can think of how to apply that to your daily life. Like for example, how can I relate to the story of Musa alayhi salam? Right? Me as an individual, how can I relate to his story? So for each of us, the way we relate to it could be different. Maybe I take some different lesson from it, that someone else takes a different lesson from it, that's perfectly fine. Because that's not necessarily tafsir, that's not explaining it. What's being warned against is this interpretation of its divine rulings and extracting rulings from the Qur'an, which should be left to the experts. Go ahead.
So, you talked about the dunya and like trying and chasing dunya, and how in this, you know, society we're kind of really caught up in it, and specifically Southern California is more of a good example,
yeah,
for obvious reasons. But I feel feel like, you know, you have to live in the society and you have to meet certain, like, you know,
expectations.
Expectations. But at the same time, you know, you always want to keep your balance of dunya or deen and try to balance that out. I feel like it's really easy to get caught up in those expectations and chasing money and chasing things. And we're all guilty of it. We all do it to some extent. And we all want to have nice things. But even harder in this to society. So, like, struggling with that balance, like, what's your practical recommendation?
I mean, for that, it really varies from individual to individual. But, like, the general parameter is that as long as your, like, engagement in the world is not taking you away from your obligations, right? It's not taking you away from your prayer. It's not taking you away from your fast. It's not causing you to fall into sin. Then that is the balance that you're trying to look for. So, again, there's absolutely nothing wrong with, like, trying to earn money and trying to get rich and trying to get advanced and ahead in this world. But all of it has to be done within permissible parameters, right? So it shouldn't be leading you to something like you're going to become unethical in the way you do business, or it's going to lead you towards lying and cheating and swindling people, or it's going to lead you to do something haram. That you always keep those boundaries in mind. So if my pursuit of extra money or my pursuit of, you know, better things takes me away from the masjid, or it takes me away from praying and it causes me to delay and miss prayer, then that's probably an imbalance. But if I'm able to do both, then that's like what you try to keep in. So just general guideline is as long as not taking away from your obligations, right? Towards Allah primarily, and then also towards other people. That shouldn't take you away from your obligations towards your parents and your siblings and your neighbors, etc. Which is hard. And striking that balance is, that's the challenge. And it's probably one of the toughest challenges that we face. Just because you said that's in SoCal, more than any other place perhaps in America, it's very materialistic. We live in a very, very materialistic society where there's a lot of competition between people, right, in terms of what car you drive and where you live and what school my children go to and what profession my children are in. It's a very competitive lifestyle. And that competition is part of life. Right? Even in the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Surah Hadid, He describes that this is what happens in life. As each phase you go through, you're going to get caught up in it. But the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in the Quran, it comes to teach us how to gain that balance. Right, so even for example, there were some companions that they asked about the private worship of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So one of the wives described it to them, and they thought it to be a little bit. They said, you know what, that doesn't seem like much, but he's the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam when we're not. So one of them says that, you know what, from now on I'm going to fast every single day. The other one said, you know what, from now on I'm going to pray all night long. And then the third one said, from now on I'm not going to ever get married. So when the Prophet ﷺ heard this, he actually became upset. He became angry. And he went and he called all three of these companions. He told them, look, you should look towards my example. That look, I sleep a part of the night, but I also pray a part of the night. That I fast some days and some days I don't fast. And I get married too. I engage in marriage. So it's that balance. You're supposed to maintain this balance. And I guess a very important point is that if one of the most defining qualities of our faith is balance and moderation. وَجَعَلْنَاكُمْ أُمَّةً وَسَطًا. Right, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, we have made you this balanced, moderate nation. So Islam recognizes on one hand that we live in this world, we live in this dunya. And that's why all of these asbab of this dunya have been created. And that's why we have been attracted towards these things as well. Right? That's how the world works. But at the same time, we're being reminded that there is a akhirah. And our purpose and our goal is something else. So I guess the way they explain this is, as long as you're not making the asbab, the means, the ends, you're good to go. Right? Keeping everything in this proper place, this proper perspective. How to do that? Challenging. Right? And it varies from person to person. Alright, so we will break today. We'll stop for prayer, inshallah. And we'll continue next week from verse number 45. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept this from us and place on our scale of good deeds on the day of judgment. Subhanallah bihamdihi, subhanakallah bihamdik, nashhadu an la ilaha illa anta, nastaghfiruka wa natubu ilayk. Jazakumullah khairan, wassalamu alaykum wa rahmatullah.